Ladies and gentlemen, lace up those cleats for another incredible Sagebrush service. We've got a great lineup for you today. Make sure those helmets are on tight because Todd is about to hit the field with his message.
That's right, Cammie. Now, before we jump over to our message, let's take a look at what could be coming our way. Our stats team is calling an 88% probability of what we call a classic Toddism. You know, like wiggity whack and boom shakalaka.
And we're projecting a whopping 100% likelihood of him diving into the actual playbook and stressing the importance of getting in the game and executing the play.
Talk about calling the shots. If I were a betting man, I would go all in on the fact that he's definitely going to express his quote-unquote pity for the Cowboys at least 10 times.
You think he's gonna waste his time on the Cowboys? Come on, this isn't the 90s. The Chiefs are playing the 49ers. That's where the real beef is at.
Well, I guess only time will tell. Stay tuned as we eagerly watch how this whole thing unfolds.
Are you ready? Well, I'm glad that you're here with us today. We're continuing our series called Get in the Game. We're looking at the different playbooks, so actually the actual plays that we have as a church. And our hope is that you would incorporate these into your personal life, and also that we would incorporate these things corporately together so that we could attack and kick down the very gates of hell. So let's get right into it today. Mark Buchanan tells the story of a time he was at a fundraiser for a school for special needs kids. He ran into a gentleman who was a dad of a special needs student. He said, "Can I tell you a story of something that happened the other day when I was at the park?" And Mark said, "Absolutely, I'd love to hear the story." Well, the dad said, "Listen, we were just walking through the park and we came upon a pickup baseball game." Now, for those of you who don't play sports, you don't know what a pickup baseball game. It's basically where a bunch of neighborhood kids get together. They join together at the park and there's no adult supervision. They just kind of divide teams and they play the game. So there's this pickup game that's going on, and the dad and his son, Shay, are watching the game, and Shay kind of makes it known to his dad that he really wants to be a participant in the game. Well, the dad said, "I didn't know what to do. It was kind of an awkward situation." So he walks over to the dugout, talks to the pitcher of one of the teams, says, "Hey, my son over here would really like to be a part of the team. Is there any way you could give him an at-bat?" And right there in that moment, the pitcher made an executive decision. He said, "You know, we're getting ready to enter into the bottom of the eighth. We're down by 6 runs. I don't see us rallying anytime soon. You know, we get to the bottom of the ninth, we'll let him have a bat. In fact, he can come on in the dugout if he likes." Oh, Shay was so excited with all of his newfound friends. He was smiling from one side of his face to the other side, just as giddy as he could be. Well, wouldn't you know it, in the bottom of the eighth, they rallied a little bit. They're only down 3 runs. In the bottom of the ninth, the bases were loaded. There was 2 outs. And guess whose turn it was to come up to bat? It was Shay's turn. So the dad said, "I'm sitting there in the bleachers and I'm wondering, are they going to renege on this? Are they going to allow my son to have an at-bat?" And he said, "Well, I get it. You know, they're out here and they're playing. They're having a great time. And there's a competitive spirit here and they've rallied back and there's excitement in the air. I could see them bypassing it." Well, the kids saw the dilemma that they were in as well. And so they got together in a huddle in the dugout and they made their decision. And the dad said, "I was shocked when I saw Shay run out of the dugout with a bat in his hand. They were going to allow him to bat after all." Now, Shay has never held a bat before. He doesn't know which side of the bat to even hold on to. Never stood in a batter's box before. So he gets up there as best he can. And the pitcher on the opposing team sees what's going on and give him credit as well. He came off the pitcher's mound just a few feet in front of Shay and began to lob the ball over so he could connect the bat with the ball. Well, Shay swung wildly and it was crazy and he wasn't even close to hitting the ball. And that's when one of his newfound friends from the dugout came running out, put his arms around him, helped him hold the bat just right. And then when the pitcher lobbed the next pitch, they connected, hit a little bunt, dribbled up to the pitcher. Easy out to first base. Well, everybody began to scream, "Run, Shay, run." So he took off for first base, and wouldn't you know it, but the pitcher threw the ball way over the first baseman's head. I mean, so far over, nobody will. He did it intentionally. And so the guy who's coaching first base tells Shea, run to second, Shea, run to second. Well, he peels around first base. He's laughing so hard. He's smiling so big. He can't even run a straight line. There's so much joy coming out of him. He gets around second base. Of course, the first baseman gets the ball, throws away over the second baseman's head. Kid just keeps on running around third. Of course, there's a close play at home, and Shea is safe. He wins the game. And then something awesome happens. Both teams gather together at home plate. They pick up Shea on their shoulders and carry him off as the hero that he was. Isn't that a great story? That's such a great story. And you look at that and you say, wow, I'm just shocked. You know, it gives us hope for the future, doesn't it? Just a bunch of kids who got together to play a game. And all of a sudden they saw a need and they met the need and they put aside their competitive spirit just to make the day of this young child a memory that that child will have forever. We love stories like that. We applaud stories like that. We smile over, we tear up over stories like that. To see an act of selflessness, it just warms our heart, doesn't it? I think the reason it affects us this way is we just don't hear about these things very often. And we live in a dog-eat-dog world where everybody's looking out for themselves, right? Kind of stories that we hear are the kind of stories you parents endure every single day if you have more than one child. There was a mom, and she was making breakfast for her two sons, ages 9 and 7. She's making them some pancakes, and they were having a fight. They were having a fight over who's going to get the first pancake. Well, the mom saw this as an opportunity for a teaching lesson. She said, you know, if Jesus was here, she'd give his brother the first pancake. And without missing a beat, the older brother turned to the younger and said, good, you be Jesus. Now that's what we're used to, right? We kind of live in a self-absorbed world where we believe that it's better to be served than to serve. And so we can see needs and we can look for somebody else to do it needs to be done. I mean, from time to time, we'll pull it off, right? From time to time, we'll do acts of service. But actually living the life of a servant, oh, that's a hard thing to do. There's a sacrifice attached, and we're so much about ourselves. I mean, what's in it for me? How do I benefit from this? I remember years ago, Christy and I were at Costco. We were living the American dream, buying in bulk. And so we're at the Costco, and we get to the peanut butter aisle, and I said, Christy, do we have any peanut butter at the house? She said, I don't know. I said, well, that's okay. We'll just call one of the kids at home, and we'll have them, you know, stop what they're doing, go to the pantry and check to see if there's any peanut butter in the house. Because, you know, when you buy peanut butter at Costco or Sam's Club, you are in it to win it. You know what I mean? That's a lot of peanut butter right there. You don't want to come home and find that you already have a couple of jars of peanut butter already. So I said, I'll just call one of the kids. Now, I'm not going to tell you which child this was to protect the guilty, but it was Hannah. It was Hannah. It was my middle child. She was laying on the couch taking a nap, I guess, or coming in and out of consciousness, I don't know. And the phone rang, and she answered the phone. Yeah. I said, hey, Mom and I are at Costco. We're wanting to know if we got peanut butter in the pantry. Can you check to see if we've got peanut butter in the pantry? She said, now? I said, yeah, now would be good, because I'm kind of standing here in the aisle. If you could just kind of get up, that would be awesome. Really appreciate that. If you could just go check the pantry, that would be awesome. Okay. And then I hear her go, and I said, are you in pain? Is something going on with you? Do we need to call 911 right now? And she starts walking across the room, and she's, and I'm thinking, what is wrong? Then I thought, well, she's kind of out of shape anyway. You know what I mean? I mean, it is a long walk. It's 10 paces to get to where the pantry's at. I said, Hannah, you know, I really appreciate you doing this as you talk on the phone that I pay for every month, as you walk to the pantry of the food that I provide for you every day. Suck it up, Hannah. Check it out. I hear her open up the door. What? What do you mean, what? Is there peanut butter in the pantry? She looked for 2 seconds. No. Bye. And hung up. 15-year-old. Not enough oxygen to the brain at that age. You understand that, right? Well, you know what's going to happen. I come home. I'm emptying the groceries. I open up the pantry. Takes me 2 seconds to see I got 2 jars of peanut butter right there. And I'm thinking, are you blind? What is wrong with you? Why didn't you see this? Friends, there's just something about us that if it's annoying to us, we don't want to do it. If it's nothing, something that's going to help us or benefit us, then we just kind of want to pass. We look for somebody else to do what needs to be done. But what if we took on the life of a servant? What if we actually followed in the footsteps of Jesus? We're looking at these plays, right? So let's look at 3 more that we have as a church. We believe the church should operate as a unified community of servants, stewarding their spiritual gifts and their resources. Let me give you another one that's similar. We believe the church should operate as the hands and feet of Jesus, giving and providing compassion to those in need. And let me give you one more play that's similar. We believe that excellence honors God and inspires people. So what does that mean? It means we believe that we're better together than we'd be apart. We believe that God has given us spiritual gifts, that we can join our arms together, that we can advance the kingdom of God. And we believe that we should give him our very best in every aspect of our life. Not just in the stuff that we do here at the church, but in our homes, at school, in our jobs, in every relationship, that we would bring excellence into it. That we'd be the kind of people that would walk into a room and we would see a need and we would naturally want to meet the need. That whatever we do, whether in word or deed, we do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That we would do it like Jesus would do it. And excellence doesn't mean perfection. It just means giving your best to the one who gave his best for you. Now here's what's interesting. Where do we come up with these concepts? Where do we come up with these ideas? Well, we get them right from the life of Christ. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 says, Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. If there was ever one who was born on this earth who was worthy of having everyone bow down before him and serve him, it was Jesus. And yet he didn't do it. He said the Son of Man came to serve, not be served. Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many. Think about the implications of what we're talking about today. Here we have the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, God Most High, making himself low. Here we have the creator of the ends of the universe serving his creation. Here we have the one who owns everything, who makes himself nothing to benefit the life of somebody else. Friends, this whole idea of serving others comes from the very core of Jesus' teachings. He said, hey, you want to be first, be last. You want to be great, be the least of all. Matthew chapter 18, Jesus is walking along the road one day with his disciples. I don't know if he's so far ahead of them, he doesn't hear what they're talking about, so far behind them, to the side of them, I don't know. But I know that there's a conversation that takes place amongst the disciples that didn't make Jesus pleased at all. Turns out, according to Mark's gospel and Luke's gospel, that the disciples are having a fight along the road over which one of them is the biggest and the baddest disciple. They always want to know. Don't you notice when you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, this is the overarching argument they have again and again and again and again. They want to know the pecking order. Hey, Jesus, who's going to sit at your left hand? Who's going to sit at your right hand when you come into your glory? Come on, Jesus, just go ahead and tell us right now. How would you rank us from top all the way down to the least? Jesus hated those conversations. He didn't want those guys to be in it to follow him for power and for authority and what they could lord over somebody else. He wanted them to serve in the same way that he was serving them and serving everybody else. And yet they were so dull to it. All they could think about was making their name great. All they could think about was their power. All they could think about was their position. And it drove Jesus insane, don't you think? I just wonder when Jesus stopped on the road and said, hey guys, what you talking about there? The Bible tells us that the disciples grew very, very silent. They didn't want to tell Jesus what was going on. Why? Because they knew that this went against the character and the attitude of Christ Jesus. They knew that Jesus would be upset. So I just imagine Jesus turning around going, hey, what's going on? What you guys fighting about? What's up? What's up? And then just say, oh, nothing. Nothing. We're fine. Nothing. Jesus said, no. You had something to say a second ago.
Let's hear what you have to say. What were you guys fighting about? And I just imagine these guys are just kind of kicking rocks back and forth, not making any eye contact with Jesus. And finally, somebody looks up and says, well, we were fighting again over which one was the greatest. Do you remember what Jesus did? He brought a child before them, didn't he? Now, the Greek tells us that the child was nothing more than a toddler, probably a child around the age of two, probably just able to run into the arms of Jesus when the child was called. And this is what he said to them as he put the child in front of them. He said, I tell you the truth, unless you change and become like little children, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. He says, guys, think about this child for just a second. Do you think this child has any ambition? That this child wants to make their name great, that this child thinks they're big and bad, and that they're worried about some kind of pecking order of who's the greatest and who's the least? Now, what is this child consumed with? The only thing this child cares about is pleasing his mom and dad. That's it. And so when the child disappoints mom and dad, when the child needs to be disciplined because they've done something wrong, the child feels sadness over that because they've let down their mom and dad, because all they care about, their whole world, is wrapped up in what? Pleasing their parent. He said, guys, you got to be like this child. Stop worrying about your power and your position and your authority and just live your life to please God. William Barclay once said, the world may assess a man's greatness by the number of people he controls and who's at his beck and call, or by his intellectual standing and academic eminence, or by the size of his bank balance and the material possessions he has amassed. But in the assessment of Jesus Christ, these things are irrelevant. We're not put on this earth to be selfish. We're put on this earth to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now, that's the first half. It's now time for the halftime show.
Wow, that first half was incredible.
Talk about a game changer. Just when you thought he was going nowhere with that story, boom shakalaka.
Now that's what I call a touchdown. He's delivering wisdom with the finesse of a seasoned running back, eluding a maze of defenders.
The good old shake and bake. By the way, have you noticed our worship team is crushing it today? Did you hear that worship set?
It truly was amazing. I can't wait to hear what they play next, and I'm already fired up.
That's right, folks. It's not just about the touchdowns and tackles. We're about to witness a musical spectacle inspirational enough to make us trade in our seats for a spot on the field.
Absolutely. The pressure is rising and the crowd's energy is through the roof. Let's get ready to show our worship team some love.
What are we waiting for? Waiting. What are we waiting for?
Can't be what we can't see. Can't speak when we can't breathe. Can't dance if we don't move our feet. It's a blur trying to keep pace. Days are running like they're in a race. Can't move if we're in our own way.
I guess the crisis is we've just one life to live, and no one knows what happens next.
So what are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? Why are we wasting all the time like someone's making more? And what are we praying for? And what are we saving for? What if we could be the light that no one could ignore? What are we waiting for?
Waiting for, waiting for.
What are we waiting for?
Put a pen on a new page. Dream about what you could change. And live it out before it's too late. Saving for what if we could.
If I love better and you love better, our love will live on forever. What are we waiting for? Why are we wasting all the time like someone's making more? What are we praying for? What are we saving for? What if we could be the light that no one could ignore? What are we waiting for?
So that's the big question, right? What in the world are we waiting for? Why aren't we getting in the game? Why aren't we living the life of a servant? Well, I don't want to sound too simplistic, but I think we think we're too good for it. Or we would be doing it, right? I think we'd rather be served than serve others. I don't think we fully understand who we are in Jesus Christ. Let me try to illustrate this for you. In Philippians chapter 1, Paul opens up the letter to the church at Philippi, and whenever he opens up a letter, he always tells people who he is, kind of gives his credentials, tells people what his position is in Jesus Christ. I want you to see what he wrote. He does this many, many times in the letters that he wrote. He says, this is Paul and Timothy, bondservants of Jesus Christ. Now, that word bondservant in the original language is doulos, which literally means slave. So let's read it again. Paul and Timothy, slaves of Jesus Christ. Now, a slave was someone who was willingly bound to another person. Now, think about this. Out of all the ways that Paul could have introduced himself to these people, he could have used any kind of title, couldn't he? Why in the world would you use the title slave? If I was Paul, I probably would have written, hey, this is Paul, and I've been in prison a whole lot, and I've been under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit writing scripture. That's what I've been doing. I've just been writing scripture left and right. And at the end of the day, I'll probably end up writing almost half the New Testament. Just wondering who I was. See, I would have written something like that, right? Or I say, this is Paul. You know, I just want you to know that I'm the guy who's been going from town to town, city to city, spreading the message of Jesus Christ. I'm the greatest missionary who's ever walked the face of the earth. I think I would have wrote that down, don't you? And then Timothy, I see Timothy hitting Paul going, hey, man, tell him about me. Tell him about me. Tell him, most influential young Christian leader that's out there right now, that I'm taking the baton from you. Tell him about me. Tell him about me. No, none of that happened. What do you need to know about Paul and Timothy? Well, we're just slaves of Jesus Christ. We have willingly bound ourselves to Jesus. Now, you hear the term slave. You think of slavery in the sense of someone going to a foreign country and chasing people down, tying them up, bringing them back on boats, selling them. That's not the slavery that we read about in the Old and the New Testament. The slavery that we read about in the Old and the New Testament was two people who came together and made an agreement, a covenant with each other. Here's how it would work in the Bible so you understand this. If you had a debt, and the debt was so great there was no way you could pay it back, you would go to the master of your debt, and you would ask them, if you wanted to, this was voluntary, if you wanted to, you would go to them and say, listen, can I come and be a part of your family? And in return, I'll work for you, and over the course of time, if you would pay off my debt, that would give me a new lease on life. And so the person who owed the debt would come and say, would you be willing to enter into this? And then the master had a decision to make as well. Because if the master brought that person into their family, they became a part of their family, kind of an adopted person of their family. They would sit at the master's table. They would eat from the master's food. And so there was a decision that needed to be made. So will you take me on to pay off my debt? And then the master would have to make a decision. Then he would provide a place for them to live. He would provide food for them. They would work off their debt. And then God made a provision that after 6 years, the debt would be wiped clean. Look what the Bible says here, Deuteronomy chapter 15. If a fellow Hebrew, a man or a woman, sells himself to you, so it's voluntary, and serves you for 6 years, in the seventh year, you must let him go free. But if your servant says to you, I don't want to leave you because he loves you and your family and is well off with you, then take an awl and push it through the earlobe into the door, and he will become your servant for life. So servants were given the option. After 6 years, your debt was paid and free. You could go and enjoy your new lease on life if you wanted to, away from the master. But what happened overwhelmingly is that people wanted to stay. They would say things like, I want to be with you forever. You provided a roof over my head. You've taken care of me. You've fed me. You've paid off my debt. I love being a part of this family. Life with you is greater than any life without you. And so if they'd made that decision, they would take an awl and they would puncture the earlobe, and that person would become a part of their family for the rest of their existence. Now, isn't that what Jesus did for us? We owed a tremendous debt, and there was no way we could pay the debt back. And so we came to him and said, would you take this debt for us? Will you pay my sin debt? And then Jesus has an option, opportunity here. He says, I want you in my family. I want you to sit at my table. I'll put a roof over your head. I'll love you like you've never been loved before. I'll forgive you like you've never been forgiven before. I'll give you a new lease on life. And then you're so blown away at the generosity of Jesus and how much he loves you and how good he's been to you that you want to stay with him. You say, I can't imagine doing life without you. Life with you is far greater than life apart from you. I've already lived that. I don't ever want to go back to that ever again. And so there's this mutual agreement, you see, that takes place in all of this. And over the course of time, you so fall in love with Jesus that you want to serve him. It shouldn't be a have to. It should be a get to. I get to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I get to love God and I get to love others, and I do it all out of my relationship with him. There was a little boy, and his dad had really dirty boots on from working. And so one night, he just took it upon himself, didn't tell anybody, didn't ask anybody, he just cleaned up his dad's shoes. Well, he put his dad's shoes by his bed while his dad slept. And the next morning, dad woke up. He was so pleased to see that his shoes were shined, that his son did such a nice thing for him, that the dad wrote a little note, got a silver dollar, went in the little boy's bedroom while he slept, and put the note in one shoe and the silver dollar in the other shoe. Basically, the note said, hey, thank you so much. Here's a dollar for your time and trouble. Well, the next day goes by, and then the next morning comes, and the dad gets ready to put his boots on, and he finds a note from the little boy in one shoe and the silver dollar that he had given the boy the day before in the other shoe. This is what the little boy wrote. I didn't do it for money. I did it for love. Here's your silver dollar back. Why do you serve the Lord? Isn't it because you love him? Because if you do it out of obligation, if you do it out of guilt, if somehow, some way, some preacher at some point in time has guilted you into serving God, you won't last very long. But when your heart flows with love for God and love for others, you'll realize that just doing acts of service compared to being a servant, walking in a room, seeing a need, it's just, life is so much better when you live your life as a servant. M. Scott Peck is a psychologist. He had a woman patient who was severely depressed, and he had been meeting with her for several years, never could get a breakthrough with her. Well, one morning she calls on the phone, says, I can't make the appointment today, my car broke down. And the doctor said, well, I'll just swing by and I'll pick you up and we'll just go ahead and have the appointment. I really want to meet with you. And she said, all right, if you want to do that, that's fine. So he swings by, picks her up. And he says, I got one little short little errand. I got to run at the hospital real quick before we have our appointment. So they pull up in the hospital parking lot and he gets out of the car and he says, you know, change of plans. He said, I got a couple of patients up here who haven't had a visit in a long, long time from somebody from the outside world. How about you go up there and you visit with them? Well, she was reluctant. She said, this is going to be a little off-put. It's going to be a little strange. Me just walking in. I don't know these people at all. He said, just give it a shot. So she did. Hour and a half later, they met back at the car. This woman was more joyful than she had been in decades. She was on an emotional high. She had never felt so good in her entire life. She said, those conversations with those ladies were phenomenal. They lifted my spirit so very much. And Dr. Peck said, this is wonderful news. We now know what to do about your depression. And she looked at the doctor and she said, you don't expect me to do this every day, do you? Isn't that the dilemma for us? You've had moments, I've had them, where you do something really kind for someone and it makes a difference in their life and you feel so good in that moment, don't you? But then we go back to being kind of more self-absorbed and making it more about ourselves. And we go back to this world that's
not very fulfilling. Because we don't really believe that living the life of a servant is better. And so we keep going back to the old things. I know some of you are skeptical right now. You mean, Todd, you mean I every environment, every moment, I'm looking for needs and meeting needs, that's the way you want me to live my life? Yeah, absolutely that is. If you don't get it, I understand the disciples didn't get it. And they were with Jesus 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for three and a half years. I mean, just hours before Jesus dies for the sins of all mankind as the ultimate act of servanthood, wouldn't you say? Jesus has gathered together with his disciples in the upper room. They're having a conversation. There's an argument that is taking place. You see, they gather together to have the Passover meal. And the disciples are frustrated because there isn't anybody at the door to wash feet. You see, in the first century, streets were filthy. There was no sewer system. There was just a bunch of junk on the streets and dust, and people wore open-toed sandals and things like that, if they wore shoes at all. And then you would come to the Passover meal. It was a three-hour meal. You would sit at this U-shaped table, and the table was just like 3-6 inches off the ground was all it was. It wasn't like we have today where you put a chair under the table. And you would recline on your elbow and you would take the food and you would eat it, but someone else would be reclining next to you, and so their feet would be in close proximity to your face. Now, if you're going to have a three-hour meal, you probably don't want, you know, someone's feet in your face, but if you have to have someone's feet in your face, the very least is you want those feet to be cleaned, right? So the disciples, they walk in there and there's the basin of water and there's the towel. Now, here's what's interesting. No self-respecting Jew would ever wash feet. When they hired someone to do this, you would never be able to hire a Jewish person because it would be beneath them to do this. I think Jesus has set this up to be a teaching moment for his disciples. Luke's gospel tells us that they're fighting. What are they fighting about now? Same-o, same-o. Who's the greatest? Come on, what's the pecking order? I'm too good to wash your feet. I think I'm too good to wash your feet. They're stubborn. They're arrogant. They're self-absorbed. And can you imagine Jesus thinking to himself, I have spent three and a half years with you guys, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, showing you a better way, day after day after day, and you still don't get it. They're all fighting over position and power. They're all fighting over a throne. No one's fighting over the towel. And I just see that Jesus is frustrated in this moment. Because think about this. The disciples, they have absolutely no reason to feel superior, do they? What is the only thing that made the disciples' lives significant? It was that they had a relationship with Jesus. They were just a bunch of fishermen, a bunch of tax collectors from other occupations and walks of life. They were the washouts. They were the nobodies. What did they have to boast and to brag about? What did they think of themselves? Why did they think so highly of themselves? Same question for us. Friends, if we're going to boast about anything, let's boast in this, that we know Jesus and that Jesus knows us. Because 100 years from now, no one's going to even know you were ever alive. 100 years from now, your great-grandchildren aren't going to sit around and talk about you and what you did and what you accomplished. You're but a mist. You're but a vapor. The only thing that brings about significance is Jesus. It's loving God and loving others. Well, Jesus is frustrated. Look at what happens. John 13, verse 1 says, having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he'd come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took out his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. And after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. Now, here's what gets me. He knows the future of the feet that he's washing. All 24 of those feet in just a few hours are going to run away in the Garden of Gethsemane and allow Jesus to face his execution alone. Two of those feet are going to deny ever knowing him. Two of those feet are going to doubt that he ever rose again from the dead. And two of those feet, Judas's feet, well, they'll run over to the high priest's house. And there he'll gather up the soldiers and go to the Garden of Gethsemane to have Jesus arrested. And in the Garden of Gethsemane, he will give Jesus the betrayer's kiss. Jesus knows exactly what those feet are going to do. And he washes all their feet. All 24. I'd have passed on Judas. And if I did wash his feet, I'd have used boiling water. That's what I would have done. I'd say, get used to the heat, Bubba, where you're going, I'll tell you right now. He washed the feet of those who hated him, of those who despised him, those who doubted him, of those who denied him. He washed the feet of those who betrayed him. He washed all their feet. He said, do you understand what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, that's what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant's greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them. Not if you talk about them. Not if you later in the week get with your small group and discuss it. Not if you memorize the verse of Scripture. No, if you actually live it out. So what are you going to do? Because the basin of water and the towel are right there for anyone who wants to take it up. Will you? Can you imagine how this would revolutionize every aspect of your life? A husband and a wife just trying to figure out how to outserve the other. Wow, that would be a picture of a beautiful marriage, wouldn't it? A child just trying to serve their mom and dad. Parents would pass out left and right all over the country. What in the world just happened right there? I tell you what. Teenagers going to their middle school and their high school just trying to serve their fellow students and serve their teachers. It would revolutionize our schools, wouldn't it? It'd change everything. Imagine you walking into your job and you're just there to serve your coworkers and serve your boss and bring value to other people. But you're not doing acts of service. You're a servant. Everywhere you go, every opportunity, you see a need, you meet the need. And then what happens? Oh, Fred, you're more alive than you've ever been before. You're being used by God in ways that you never dreamed, and you're making an impact with your one shot at life, but only if you take up the towel. So what are you going to do with it? What are you going to do with it? I think about this church. If we could move as a group of people from doing acts of service occasionally to just being servants, oh man, the impact we could make. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, what are we waiting for? We got to get in the game. And it's more than just serving in some ministry in the church, it's just serving. It's just being a servant. Because it's for you. You said, whatever we do for the least of these, we did it for you. Help us to never forget that. So, Lord, if we've become self-absorbed, selfish, if we've made life about ourselves, if we find it to be a nuisance to help somebody else along the way, Lord, rid us of that sin. That's not going to bring joy. That's not going to help anybody. And that's not the life that you've called us to live. It's certainly not the life you lived. So help us, Lord, to follow in your footsteps, to be your hands and your feet, to take up the towel and wash feet. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.